I'm Yafit Clymer. This is our third class. We start reading the introduction to the book of Exodus last week, and I want you to see today. That's the new sources I've sent you. I wanted to go over the introduction by Ramban. Like the prologue that he writes to his entire commentary on the book of Exodus, and he continues what we saw. He continues what we saw last week, but he has his emphasis, as we saw in the Midrash, on the light and the dark. And but Ramban, Rabbi Moshe ben Nachman, Nachmanides, who lived in Spain in the 13th century, he was one of the great leaders of that Renaissance time in Spain. He had to leave Spain after a big dispute or debate he had with a very famous convert, a Jew who converted to Christianity, Pablo Cristiani, who told the king, Jacob the First, Yaakov Harishon in Spain, that the Jews, all they have in their holy writing is things against Jesus and against the king. So the king called the Ramban to come and debate with Pablo Cristiani, and he actually won. The king decided that Ramban gave good answers. But nevertheless, after a year, the Inquisition and the Christian the Christian authorities came to the king and changed his mind and said, "Well, if you're not gonna punish the Ramban for winning the debate, that's gonna cause a lot of trouble because Jews will start thinking, you know, they can that they're better than us." And the king, because he was fairly a good king, he called Ramban and he said, "Listen, I'm giving you a month. Take up your family, take up your stuff, and leave Spain. Because if not, I won't be able to protect you." And that's why Ramban left Spain and moved to the land of Israel. And to his happiness, actually, he was very pleased to be in Israel. So we're talking about the 13th century. And the Ramban is the first commentator to add in his commentary a new thing that never happened before, and that is the new mysticism, the secrets of the reading of the Torah from the Kabbalah, from the Zohar, and the Ramban, being a mystic himself, is writing a commentary that is also based on the Midrashim of Chazal, but also and sometimes even the plain understanding of the verses, but also adds a secretive aspect to what he's writing. And he was really a giant. He wrote also a commentary on the Talmud, and he's giving us like a vision from above on the entire Pentateuch. And when he talks about Exodus, and I you have here the Hebrew and the English, and so this is what the Ramban is saying about Sefer Shemot before he starts to give a commentary on each and every verse. So Ve'ele Shemot, and these are the names of the children of Israel in the book of Genesis, which is the book of creation. The Torah completed the account of how the world was brought forth from nothing and how everything was created. So two things are important here to the Rambam to mention. One is that the Genesis is the book of creation, Sefer HaBri'ah. This is the book of creation, and the Torah completed the account is the Torah in the book of Genesis is telling you how the world was brought forth from nothing to everything that we see today. And with that, he's following the steps of the Rambam, Maimonides, that his main criticism or disagreement with the Aristotle point of view on the world was on the question, was there something in the world that from that something God created the world? And the Rambam said, no, the Jewish perspective, the Jewish belief, the Jewish theological understanding is that God created the world something from nothing. There was nothing, and God, by his words, by his action, by anything, everything that we cannot understand, created the world. And it's important for the Ramban, Nachmanides, to say it as well, from nothing and how everything was created, as well as an account of all the events which befell the patriarchs, who are a sort of creation to their seed. Okay, so that's another interesting statement by the Ramban. The beginning of the book of Genesis is how the world was created, and the first few hundreds of years. But then when we come to talk about the patriarchs, why is that considered to be creation? Because the Ramban believes that everything that happened to our forefathers and foremothers, to the patriarchs and the matriarchs of Am Yisrael, it was like creating a path to their children. So it's not just the creation of the world, it's also a creation of paths in humanity by Adam v'Chava, by Noach to the 70 nations, by Abraham to his children, and then by Yitzchak and Yaakov to the Jewish, to Bnei Israel, to the children of Israel. And that is also a Genesis. That is also some sort of creation. It's creating a path to their seeds, to their offsprings, to their children, to the nation to come. And all the events that happened to them were symbolic occurrence indicating and foretelling all that was destined to come upon their seeds. Okay, and I want you to show the Hebrew. It's a famous sentence by the Ramban. Ramban Omer. ולהודיע כל עתיד לבוא להם, ואחרי שישים יצחיל לעניין בעניין הדבר, מן הרמזים ההם, ויצירת כל נוצר ומקרי אבות, שהם יצירה לזרעם. Okay, מקרי ציוריהם. This is the sentence. מקרי ציוריהם. Like everything that happened to our forefathers, everything that happened to the three fathers and the four mothers is indicating something that will happen to the children. Their story is creating something in the world that we can see the pattern that happened to them happening to their children. And it's, as he says, it's symbolic occurrences indicating and foretelling all that's going to happen to their seed. And after having completed the account of the creation, the Torah begins another book concerning the subject that had been alluded to in those symbolic events recorded in the book of Genesis. The book of Shemot, Exodus, is what happened to their children, which is symbolic to what happened to the forefathers. And if we look, and says the Ramban, that's why Exodus is actually a continuance of the book of Genesis, as we read last week, of the commentator who said it's book one and book two. It's not two separate topics. It's continuing. Sefer Shemot continues the book of Genesis, because after we saw and understood the life of the patriarchs, now we can understand the life of their children. But it's happening in a different land. It's happening in Mitzrayim. And says the Ramban, the book of Ve'ele Shemot was set apart from the story of the first exile, which had been clearly decreed, and the redemption, therefore. The book of Ve'ele Shemot was set apart for the story of the first exile. the children of Israel go down to Egypt, says the Ramban, let's look what it is. It's an exile. They were in the land of Israel and they had to move to Egypt, but it was supposed to be temporarily till the famine on Canaan will end. But they found themselves, you know, dwelling in the land of Egypt for hundreds of years. That was an exile. The seeds to that was already in the stories of Abraham. Abraham, there was a famine in the land of Canaan, and he went down to Egypt, but then he had some struggling with Paro and with Sarai, what happened to her, and it happened again with Avimelech, and it happened again with Yitzhak, who didn't go to Egypt, but he had a thing with famine and a foreign king. And obviously Yaakov didn't go to Mitzrayim first. He went to Haran and stayed there for 21 years. And then he goes down to Egypt. In other words, it was as if the Ramban is saying, everything that happened in Sefer Shemot, we could see it seeds in the book of Genesis. It was already there in the book of in Bereshit. And it was clearly decreed, and the redemption therefore. In other words, if we hear about an exile in the Jewish tradition, as we understand in the Jewish text, the other side of the coin of exile is redemption. Whenever you see exile, you should know redemption will come. That happened to Abraham, that happened to Yaakov, and that's what's going to happen to their children. And if you remember the beautiful story about Rabbi Akiva and his friends, after the destruction of the second temple, Rabbi Akiva is walking with his friends at the outskirts of Jerusalem, and they're all crying to see, you know, the ruins of the temple. And Rabbi Akiva is laughing, and they tell him, how can you laugh? We are watching destruction. And he says, no, you see only one part. I see the other part. I see the part of the prophecy that said, if we see exile, if we see destruction, there will also be redemption. And that's what Ramban is saying. Ramban, and the amazing thing about what he's saying is the fact that he lives in a deep, deep, deep exile. You know, he's living in Spain in the 13th century. Jews were in exile for 800 years already. There are very, very, very few Jews in Israel. The entire world Jewry is scattered around the world, in North Africa, in Egypt, in Spain, in Germany, in Italy, in France. Where else? Some in the area of Bavel. But this is like Jews are secondary citizens. They suffer from you know, persecutions by the Christian world or the Islam world. And when the Rambam, I feel that when the Rambam writes his introduction to the book of Genesis, of Exodus, he said he's talking to the people in his time, and he's telling them, listen, it's true. It's really, really horrible, and we are in exile. But don't forget that the other side is redemption, and it will come. It might not come in our generation, but it will come. And this is like a code word that was passed on from generation to generation in the Jewish world, saying, you know, we've been there in Genesis, we've been there in Egypt, we've been there, we left Egypt, we got into the Holy Land, we were exiled again to, you know, amongst the nations, but we will be back again, and redemption will come. And this is why, says the Ramban, this is why he reverted and began this second book of the Torah with the names of those people or persons who went down to Egypt. Why do we have to read the names again? We read them at the end of Sefer Bereshit. Why do we open the book of Exodus? Ele Shemot, these are the names of the Jews, of the children of Israel who went down to Egypt. And so why do we do that and mention their total number, although this had already been written? It is because their descent thereto constituted the beginning of the exile, which began from that moment on. And the Ramban is saying something very interesting. He says the description of the people of the children of Israel going down to Egypt at the end of the book of Genesis belonged to a story that was supposed to be temporary. But when we open the book of Shemot, we already know that this is going to take a long time. So we have to remind ourselves the names of those people who came down to Egypt, and from them we started, you know, to become a nation in exile who needed redemption, and the rest of the story, because it starts here. It starts by the people, the 70 people who came down to Egypt, and all of a sudden became, you know, a huge number of people. And as we saw last week, and the first person who calls them a nation looks at them and says, hey, they're not a family anymore. They're not even a huge family anymore. They became a people. That was Pharaoh. Continues the Ramban and says, now the exile was not completed until the day they returned to their place and were restored to the status of their fathers. The end of the story is not even leaving Mitzrayim. The end of the story is only when they'll go back to the land of Canaan, because that will end the story. Their forefathers came down, came from out of Canaan to Canaan, and then they went down to Egypt, and the story will end, will have a closure only when they restore their status of their fathers and go and be, you know, their own people in the land of Canaan. And when they left Egypt, even though they came forth from the house of bondage, they were still considered exiles because they were in a land that is not theirs. It took time. That's another step. Well, first we thought that when we leave Mitzrayim, okay, that's redemption. No, redemption will be completed only with entering the land of Israel. But then, says the Rambam, that's not even enough. When we come to the land is not ours. We have to conquer the land from the people in the land with the help of God. We don't feel yet that the land is ours, even though God promised our forefathers that the land is ours. And entangled in the and they're still not theirs, and they're entangled in the desert. And when they came from Mount Sinai and made the tabernacle, and the Holy One, blessed He, caused His divine presence to dwell again amongst them, they returned to the status of the fathers when the secret of God was upon their tent, and they were those who constituted the chariots of the Holy One, and then they were considered redeemed. It was for this reason that this second book of the Torah is concluded with the consuming of the building of the tabernacle and the glory of the eternal filling it always. Now, what does the Rambam means here? And the Rambam says, if the goal is entering the land of Canaan, fine, so let us wait till we get to Canaan, and then build the Mikdash, and everything will be completed. And he said, no. In that aspect, God was very merciful with us. And he knew that the people of Israel, in order to have, you know, the patience to wait till they go to the land of Israel, they need to know that God is dwelling amongst them. And that's why he's giving an order to build the tabernacle. And the tabernacle was actually, you know, it was a tent they can pick up, you know, fold into a few boxes and carry with them to the next step when they stop, and took it out and rebuild it and then repack it again and move on. It's not a permanent building. The Mishkan is something you can take everywhere with you. Ramban is not saying it here, but if I continue his idea, in the desert for the people of Israel left Mitzrayim, it was important for them to feel, to know, to see something physical that expressing the fact that God's Shekhinah is dwelling amongst the people. But the fact that the Mishkan was portable, that the tabernacle was portable, I think is also a foreshadowing, or as the Ramban is saying, like it's symbolic for later, because we all know when the people of Israel will enter the land of Israel, but after a few hundred years, they will be in the land of Israel for 800 years, and then the first exile will happen, destruction of the first temple by Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babel, and we go to Galut Babel, the exile of Babel, and then we come back, and then again, after the destruction of the second temple, we're scattered around the Roman Empire, and definitely after Bar Kokhba's rebellion. And in a way, the fact that the people of Israel know that once upon a time in the desert, the dwelling of God was portable, that meant that we don't really need the building in Yerushalayim in order to carry God with us. So when the temple was destroyed twice, the people of Israel, wherever they could be with the instruction of the Chachamim, they could be their own tabernacle. And they could, if they carry God within them, their Jewish identity would remain. And in a miraculous way, really, it's like a historical detail or fact that all historians don't have to be Jewish in order to acknowledge that remarkable fact of the Jewish existence through more than 2,500 years of keeping the same language and the religion and the belief of God, with not having a center, not a political center, not a spiritual center, because the centers moved in to the communities after the temple was destroyed. It moved into the shuls, it moved into the communities, it moved into the soul of the people. And I think the symbol for that, or the precedent for that, was the tabernacle in the desert. There's another beautiful thing that I want to say about the tabernacle, because I don't know if we'll get to the building of the tabernacle at the end of the book of Exodus, because I just want to move the people of Israel from a family to a nation. But I just want to say something about the tabernacle that Rabbi Sachs, Zecher Tzadik Livracha, loved to mention. And he said that he used to have a weekly meeting with Tony Blair when he was the Prime Minister of England. And Tony Blair is a very religious person, a Christian, of course, and he loved learning Bible with Rabbi Sachs. And Rabbi Sachs said that he never knew what's the topic that Tony Blair will bring every time he came. He didn't prepare anything, and he would come, and Tony Blair would ask him a question, and he said one time I get there, and he's like, Tony Blair is like, I don't understand these. I don't understand these boring chapters at the end of the book of Exodus. So many details, so many parts. Why do we have to hear so twice the building of the tabernacle? What's so important of the building of the tabernacle? And Rabbi Sachs said, well, let me even enhance your question. If we count the verses of the description of creating the world, we have, I hope I get the number right, we have 36 or 31 verses. When we look at the Purakim, the chapters that describe the tabernacle, we're talking about hundreds of verses. And Rabbi Sachs says, you know why? Because for God to create the world, it's nothing. But for us human beings to create a place for God, well, that takes a lot of work. That takes a lot of intense and a lot of doing the right thing. And I think that's very beautiful. But the comparison between between the chapters of the of. In other words, when we look at the entire book of Shemot, it's true. The description of the tabernacle takes a lot of time, because it is important, because this is the first, let's call it, vehicle of the people of Israel to feel that they belong, to feel that they have a channel to God, and they can take it with them everywhere. And they had to work hard to build it. And it's the first thing in hundreds of years of an authority telling them to build something that belongs to them. Just imagine the people of Israel in Egypt being told to build the two cities of Pitom and Ramses. Everything they did was for the Egyptian rulers. Everything they did, including the lives that they lost, building all these places, to be a slave. And I go back now to the beginning of Shemot. We'll see the verses again. To be a slave is never to have confidence on the next day. You don't know if you're going to die. You don't know if you're going to have food. You don't know who's from your family is going to die. You don't know what new crazy decrees the Pharaoh will bring upon you. And you only see, you know, the next step in front of you and the next moment. You can never think about the future. And a beautiful thing about being a person, and it's another thing that Rabbi Sachs really, really loved saying, is that as people, and he was quoting here a Jewish American psychologist, Martin Seligman, who is the founder of the positive psychology. You know, many of the founders of a field in psychology were Jewish. You know, Freud and Newman and Adler and Seligman and Aaron Beck, they were all Jewish, except a few of them. But Rabbi Sachs is quoting something from Seligman, that Seligman with a positive psychology said against, you know, the classic psychoanalytic approach of, let's dig in your past, let's talk about your relationship with your parents and find out all the pathologies of your past. And Seligman said, no, we have to look forward. A human being is different from the other animals in nature by the fact that we are able to think about the future. We're able to imagine things that never happened yet. And about, you know, taking our abilities and saying, you know what, I would really like to be this, or would really like to do that. And that sometimes, you know, has to make me do things in the present. But we can really think far. What God is doing in the entire process of creating a nation from a family and creating a nation that comes in a covenant with God is installing in us, first of all, the trust in His words. When I say something, you can trust me, this is what's going to happen. I am not like your Pharaoh that can promise things and you know, and disobey and regret the next minute. There's an authority, there's a God that is consistent, that is lovingly, unconditionally, and His word is a word. That's one thing. But the other thing that God is teaching those people, those slaves that became a nation and became the, you know, accepted the Torah, is start imagining a future where you can be. You know, it's a big question, you know, the question of the 40 years in the desert. Many, many answers. One answer is, well, what can we do? It's because of the meraglim, the spies, and that's a punishment. But that's not the only approach. There's other parshanim, mostly modern ones, who say, no, we had to have 40 years. It was not as a result of the sin of the meraglim. It's as if we had to, it was just an excuse. The sin of the meraglim was just an excuse, because we had to have the 40 years in order to teach us how to become a free people with freedom of choice, with a covenant with God, with new rules about how to create a society who is based on just judgment and justice. And that takes time. But I'd like to suggest another thing, that what God is keep telling the people of Israel, I will take you to the land of milk and honey. Now, it's a land they've never been to. Maybe they even forgot the stories that their forefathers and mothers told them 210 years ago. You know, who would remember? You become a slave. As I said before, you hardly think about tomorrow. Nevertheless, to think about the stories you've been told. And God is saying, well, listen, part of being human is having dreams and imagine that the possibilities that can be in the future. So yes, you have 40 years now to imagine how this land is going to be. You're 40 years now to imagine what you can do when you enter the land and what you can do as individuals, as tribes, and as a nation. And from here, I'd like to, let me just stop this and go back to the verses in Perek Aleph. I brought the English just so I wanna be clear that we have the meaning of the words for everyone in their head, and then we move into the parshanut. So we're in the beginning of Sefer Shemot. These are the names of the son of Yaakov. You know, went down to Egypt, each coming with their household: Reuven, Shimon, Levi, Yehudah, etc., etc. Verse 5: the total number of persons that were Jacob's issue came to 70, and Joseph being already in Egypt, we discussed that. And Joseph died, and all his brothers and all that generation. But the Israelites, pay attention to the word but, can Uvnei Israel, the translator here is doing a nice job. The word in Hebrew is Uvnei Israel, and in the meaning of but, in other words, it's a surprise. We would think that Joseph died and his brothers died and all the generation died, and maybe the remains of the people of Israel in Egypt will say, you know what, everyone's dead, let's just go back to Canaan. But no, all of a sudden there's a surprise. But the Israelites were fertile and prolific, and they multiplied and increased very greatly, so that the land was filled with them. And that's a big surprise. What do we do with such a pasuk? Can say Bnei Israel, and let me move to the back to the sources, and just, you know, have in mind that verse. Pasuk Zayin, Uvnei Israel, Paru, Vayishretzu, Vayirbu, Vayatzmu, Bimod, Meod, Vatimale Haaretz Otam. They were everywhere. Now, we have two, again, it's because the Torah was not giving to us in pictures, and because the Torah was not giving to us with the music in the background, you know, we have to imagine, we have to try to see the picture, and the way of the Torah to tell us the story is word by word. In other words, also technically, the Torah was written in scrolls. So if it's rolled up, so you roll it and you see one word in a time, one sentence in a time. And this is how I'd like us to read that pasuk. Uvnei Israel, when we read Bnei Israel, we think about the children of Israel, you know, the descendant of the 70 people. But then all of a sudden, paru, vayishretzu, vayirbu, vayatzmu, Bimod, meod, vatimalei haaretz otam. So many verbs and descriptions of the plentiful of those people who filled up the land. And Rashi, the famous Rashi, I'm sure we all know that Rashi. And Rashi is saying, I'm sorry, I don't have the English. I had a very busy day today. I didn't have time to find the translation. But Rashi says, v'yishretzu, shayu yoldot shisha bekeres achat. It's a famous midrash. Rashi is saying, Each woman had six babies in her womb. Why does Rashi have to say that? Because he's doing simple math. How can you become from 70 people to masses of people that are a danger to the people of to the Egyptians? So for Rashi, who accepts the midrash, if it makes sense to him, and apparently that made sense to him, and he's saying, yeah, each woman had six babies in her womb. Rashbam, the grandson of Rashi, and they had a great relationship, Rashi and Rashbam. Rashbam, Rabbi Shmuel ben Meir, was the son of the daughter of Rashi. Rashi, Rabbi Shimon Yitzchaki, the giant, the great commentator of the Bible and the Talmud, lived at in northern France at the 11th century. He had only girls, and Rashi taught them Torah. And when Rashi passed away, his students went to his daughters to make sure they understood the Torah of Rashi, that they remembered correctly. They were the mavens of the Torah of their father. It's really a great story. And one of the grandchildren of Rashi was the Rashbam. The Rashbam had a few years together with Rashi before he passed away with his grandfather. And at one point, the Rashbam, who also wrote a commentary on the Torah, writes that, "I know my grandfather promised that he's going to give the simple meaning of the text. But unfortunately," says the Rashbam, "that's not what he's doing. Because my grandfather adds a lot of midrashim, and that's not the simple meaning. But I'm going to write a commentary that is the real meaning of the verses, of the immediate and the simple meaning of the Torah, of the verse, of the psukim." And he also says that when he spoke about it to his grandfather said, "You should do that. I'm too old to rewrite my commentary, so I trust you to do a good job." And therefore, the Rashbam almost never adds midrash, the hermeneutic parts of the discussion of Chazal, in his commentary, and he's very logical and gives exactly what he thinks the words mean. So as opposed to his grandfather, who said, "How do we, you know, why do we have?" And I didn't mention that. I should mention that. Why does Rashi say six? Why six children? Because he counted the words that describe the multiplication of the women. Paru, vayishretzu, vayirbu, vayatzmu, bimod meod, six words. So because of the six words, Rashi said, six words of six children for each woman. And what does the Rashbam say? The Rashbam says, no, that doesn't make sense. Paru means they got pregnant. Vayishretzu, that means they gave birth. Why is that so amazing? Because as we know, deep into the late Middle Ages, to have a healthy birth was not an everyday thing. And many women, you know, God forbid, died during during labor or giving birth, and maybe babies didn't make it. And even if they made it, a lot of them died in a very young age. It was not, you know, sometimes we forget how lucky and how blessed we are with everything around us. Even, yes, even with Corona and COVID, et cetera, the health-wise and all the new technology and in developments is, you know, we live in definitely in good times. Now, could be better, but not forgetting the good thing we have in our life. So the Rashbam says the miracle, or the unusual thing about the Israelites' pregnancy, was the fact that every time a woman got pregnant, she had a baby. And more than that, says the Rashbam, vayirbu, and they all grew up, and the little ones became big, and they didn't die when they were young. Now, Rashbam, who also lives in France in the 12th century, is again talking about a reality that he sees, and even more so in the ancient world. So the miracle for him was not outside of nature. Yeah, it was in the rules of nature, but it was a miracle because it was unusual. And every pregnancy was healthy, and they had their child, and they grew up, and they became older people. And that's why there were so many people of the people of Israel. And that's how the Rashbam understand that. And we saw that immediately after that sentence, that verse, Pasuk Zayin, we have Pasuk Chet, verse 8, ויקום מלך חדש על מצרים אשר לא ידע את יוסף. And a new king rose over Egypt who did not know Yosef. And this verse comes right after the pasuk of how, you know, the numbers, the great number of the people of Israel. And that verse is surprising again. Also, what do you mean there is a new king who didn't know Yosef? What do you mean he didn't know yourself? You know, you have the dynasty, you have the writings, you have the history books. What do you mean that he did not know Yosef? And again, Rashi is quoting a midrash, and Rashi is saying, "Vayakom melech chadash, a new king, Rav v'Shmuel." Rav v'Shmuel were two Amoraim in Bavel at the beginning of the third century in Bavel. They were two of the great Amoraim of the Babylonian Gemara Talmud, and Rav v'Shmuel chadamar. One of them said, "Chadash mamash," like actually knew it was a new king, like it was really a new king. Echad amar shenitchadshu gzerotav, that he renewed his decrees. Now they're both saying something different, and they're both understand the reality different. Rav says if he didn't know Yosef, that means he's really new. Somehow there's a king that maybe he was too young, but somehow he doesn't know Yosef. But Shmuel says, no, no, no. After Yosef died, this king found an opportunity to abuse the people of Israel. Nitchadshu gzerotav, he renewed his decrees. The things maybe that he wanted to do all the time, but he couldn't because he had respect to Yosef and to his brothers and to the first generation of those people, all those people who died that we saw in the previous psukim. And now it's time to do to have new decrees. Asher lo yada, says Rashi, that he didn't know Joseph. Omer Rashi, asa atzmo ke'ilu lo, he pretended not to know Yosef. Of course he knew Yosef. He just pretended he didn't know because he did not want the moral obligation that the Egyptians had to Yosef for saving them from famine and having, you know, having their economy flourish. So he pretended he didn't know Yosef, therefore he could do whatever he wanted to the people of Yosef. Ibn Ezra, and if we said that Rashbam didn't follow the footsteps of his grandfather, and he had this more of a simple understanding, Ibn Ezra is the pure rationalist of the commentators at that time. Again, Spain at the 13th century. Ibn Ezra was a very, very unique character. He was a very poor man, didn't have anything, any belongings, and all the knowledge that he knew was in his head. He was a walking library. He knew the Tanakh by heart. He knew Mishnah v'Gemara by heart. He knew all the Midrashim by heart. He knew the commentaries of Rashi and Ramban, before him, he knew it by heart. He was a real phenomena. Ibn Ezra also moved. He traveled from country to country in Europe. Every time he found a new how shall I call it, a new rich person who supported him, and in return, Ibn Ezra wrote songs, poems to those rich people, and we have those poems. He was a real character and a great commentator. And he was also, again, as I said, a very, very rationalist. And he says, "Vayakom melech chadash, perusho kemashmo." Yes, don't give me now any nitchadash, renew it. He made, he pretended. It was a new thing. It can happen. But what's the rationalist reason for a king in Egypt not to know Yosef? Shelo haya mizera hamelucha. He didn't belong to the dynasty. He was a king that, you know, snapped the kingdom, maybe by a rebellion. Maybe he was a general. These things happen in the ancient world. We see it more and more when we get to the Greek and Roman empires. But Ibn Ezra is saying that's the only reasonable thing to think if you talk about the why would the Torah write that he was a new king if he wasn't a new king? He was a new king. How come he didn't know Yosef? Because he came from a different place, maybe from a different country, and he took over. We don't know. But that's why he said, that's why it says Vayakom, and he rose, right? The English says a new king arose. What do you mean a new king arose? Mazeh Vayakom. It should be Malach. Ibn Ezra says this is a hint that it is an entirely new king. Nevertheless, with many, many, many children of Israel all over the land of Egypt, and with a new, and we should say hostile, king, we move into the rest of the verses of our chapter. And this is a pasuk we saw last week, but let's continue from here. And he said to his people, look, the Israelite people are much too numerous for us. Why? What is he afraid of? Let us deal shrewdly with them, so that they may not increase otherwise in the event of a war. They may join our enemies in fighting against us and rise from the ground. Now, he's afraid that during a war, the Jews, the Hebrews, will join the enemies, and then something will happen. They will rise from the ground. And here again, there are many ways of understanding it. I think the two main ways are rise from the ground, they'll be more than us, and they'll take over our land, Egypt, and, you know, will become the rulers of our land. Or what most of the commentators agree on is that he is afraid that they will rise from the ground, they'll get up and leave Egypt and go back to their homeland. And then will we be left with no slaves, with no people to, you know, work for us, build our buildings for us, work the fields for us? And he was afraid of that. And again, I wanted to make sure that you remember that he's the first person in Tanakh that called Am Yisrael Israelite people. Am Yisrael is a name, is a description that Pharaoh is giving the people of Israel first. So what is he doing? So they set taskmasters over the Israelite to oppress them with forced labor, and they built garrison cities for Pharaoh, Pitom and Ramses. For those of you who were not born in Israel, or of course we all know the story, but when Sa'adat, the Egyptian president, came to Israel in 1977 to talk to Begin, and then, you know, they declared the peace treaty, and there was a big excitement, and there was some, you know, articles in the paper saying that, you know, after so many years, after we build the pyramids in Egypt, now we can go back to see them. And the all the scholars of the Bible, you know, hold their head and said, no, we did not build the pyramids. There's a myth that started somehow that the people of Israel, the people of Israel build the pyramids. Well, the pyramids were there for thousands of years before we went down to Egypt. Egypt, as I mentioned, was the biggest, the long-lasting empire of the ancient world. And the pyramids were there from 4000 BCE already, next to Mesopotamia, like all these great nations that were there already. What the people of Israel built is exactly what it says here. They built two cities, the city of Pitom and the city of Ramses. They built cities. And that's the labor that Pharaoh put upon them to enslave them, to make them work hard, to make them depressed, oppressed, so they will never think, to have any thoughts about freedom, any thoughts about being a one nation, any thoughts about free will. And that, and I'm saying it in brackets, I think that's because, you know, the Afro-American slaves found themselves so much, they felt a lot of sympathy to the Hebrews, and they took, you know, they took, we all know, they took the let my people go theme to be their theme of freeing themselves from slavery. Because and I go back to here, what is very, very clever, you know, a lot of rulers and dictators are very clever. We felt it in the 20th century. And he says, I have to break their spirit. How do one break one's spirit? You make them work as till they forget that they're human beings. And that's what he's doing. And they're building those cities. The cities are also very symbolic. Pitom and Ramses are after two gods. That is, Ramses was also a generic name of emperors of Egypt. Paro, Pharaoh, was one, and Ramses was another of names of kings in Egypt. And Ramses is the word Ramses is from two separate words. Ramses in Hebrew is Reish Ain. Ra was a god. He was a god who controlled almost everything in Egyptian mythology, and including the sun. And Meses is the son of. So Ramses is the son of Ra. And the kings of Egypt indeed considered themselves as the children of the gods. Mostly it was the god of sun. They loved the god of sun, Ramses and others. But Meses, the child, the son of the god Ra, and the people of Israel are building those cities. But the more they were oppressed, the more they increased and spread out. Something didn't work mathematically here. And we feel it, we see it, Paro feels it and see it. The people of Israel is also asking themselves, you know, it's against nature. The more they were oppressed, the more they increased and spread out. So that the Egyptians came to dread the Israelites and to start fearing them, because something not normal is happening to them. Something unnatural is happening to them. They have some powers. Now, they already had and this is also, in order to understand the entire story of Shemot, we should understand that in let's call it a polytheistic society is very tolerant, because there were no religious persecutions in the old time, in the ancient world, because we wanted to be the ruler, but we didn't mind everyone believing any god they want. It was true for the Akkadians, for the Babylonians, the Persians, the Assyrians, the Greeks, the Romans. They wanted the culture to be the same, but, you know, believe whatever god you want. The Assyrian, believe whatever god you want. The Persians, believe whatever god you want. So is Egypt. In other words, what was the fact that they believed many gods, and the people of Israel believed a different god, was very normal. But the tension or the struggle was whose god is stronger. That was the battle. Whose god is stronger? And the whole process, together with building a nation and letting them understand that they're more than just a family, that they will become the nation of God. We will become the nation with a message, with a mission. There was also parallel to that was the new message to the entire world, that we're bringing upon a new belief, the idea of a God which is above everyone. He's outside of the world, and he controls everything, and he created everything. And of course, he is stronger than any of the Egyptians' gods. And when it says that they came to dread the Israelite, that also means it comes together with the dread their God. Because people are not getting stronger unless their God is greater than our God. And that is a great knockout for Pharaoh, right? Because he is the greatest God. And if his people are afraid of the Israelites, that means I have to be even crueler and more tough in my demands. And the Egyptians ruthlessly imposed upon the Israelites. Now, and the situation is, and again, the entire process is a process of the unbelievable, inconceivable. Is that a good word? It's just inconceivable events. Like every sentence just doesn't make sense in everyone's perspective. And they're all living that and trying to make sense of it. At the bottom are the Israelites who are working so hard as slaves, and they can't even pick up their eyes and look up and understand what's happening. Pharaoh understands quite well that this is a battle between him and this new God that the Israelites brought with them. And his people, like Pharaoh's people, are in the middle. But the more power they put upon the people of Israel, and they try to break the spirit of the people of Israel, but number wise they're still growing, and that doesn't make sense to him. And the various labor that they made them perform ruthlessly, they made life bitter for them with harsh labor at mortar and bricks, and with all sorts of tasks in the field. Okay, they made their life bitter, and they left bitter with a harsh labor. And because we know it was all God's plan, we should ask ourselves why. Why did he have to bring the people of Israel to such a level of bitterness and harsh labor, and even, you know, give up life sometimes or give up hope, and only then bring them out? Why to bring them all the way down to the lowest level of despair and then bring them up? And again, I think if we remember what we started with the Ramban, saying that everything that happened to the Avot happened to the children, and what we find with Avraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov, Sarah, Rivka, Rachel, and Leah, they all have some sort of a private conversation with God. It was very clear to them that everything that happens to them is from God. And in a way, this pattern or this paradigm of belief is what God would like us to have in our life. In other words, is the understanding that specifically, if even so, that's when it is difficult to turn to God and to say, you can say very harsh things. The examples we have from Abraham, you know, Abraham stands up in front of God, and he's giving him criticism. He's giving him criticism on Sodom. He's like, well, God, you forgot that you're the God of justice, and how can you destroy an entire city? Maybe there's one good person there. And he also stands in front of God when God tells him, oh, I will give you everything you want. And Avraham is telling him, really? You're going to give me everything I want? The only thing I want you did not give me. You didn't give me a son before the birth. In other words, the relationship with God is not a relationship of flattering and just saying good things, and even not just saying thank you. The relationship with God is to know that in every level of existence, from the lower one to the higher one, knowing that God is there and have the accordingly conversation with him, with God. And even if what we want to say is harsh things, or maybe it's anger, or maybe it's maybe even resentment, I once heard an amazing conversation by Elie Wiesel, may he rest in peace, and Rav Yehuda Amital, may he rest in peace, both Holocaust survivors. And Elie Wiesel, who had, during his life, had very complicated relationship with God, came from a very Hasidic family. All his youth was just learning Torah, and then he lost his faith during the Holocaust, and he regained it again after. Very, very, they met a remarkable, remarkable person. And he said, I always knew that I can tell God the hardest and the harshest things that I want to tell him. And he adds, I had good reasons, you know, to rebuke God. That's what he says. But the one thing I knew that I can do and I won't do is chutzpah. I hope everyone understands what chutzpah is, because I don't know how to explain it in English. Okay, so and what does chutzpah mean? Chutzpah means maybe is to tell God, oh, you know, you should have done this and this and this. Not to tell God what to do, but the things that God does do to us, we can turn to him and say, like, well, we don't understand that. So in a way, maybe, and that's just a suggestion, that what God is waiting for Hebrews to happen is for them to get to that point in the lowest level, that at that point they will all of a sudden remember the God of their forefathers, like, oh yeah, we have her to turn to. Okay, we'll continue next week, Bezrat Hashem. Thank you. Stay healthy.
Thank you.
Bye. Bye, Susan.
Bye, Fit.
Shavua Tov, everyone.
Chodesh Tov.
Chodesh Tov, yes. Chodesh Tov, true.
Thank you.
You're very welcome.